I do also would like to bring to your attention one of the hats that I wear, which links to the cross-disciplinarity, that is being one of the science committee members of the research program, global research program established by the International Council for Science in conjunction with the United Nations International Strategy for Disaster Risk Reduction and the International Social Science Council. And this program is called Integrated Research and Disaster Risk Reduction. Again, as we speak, in terms of background, it's very clear that if you bring agendas with a global offer now together, you are very much speaking to interdisciplinarity and transdisciplinarity. Taking time to emphasize those points while delving into my presentation, because I think and feel believe that geoinformatics research, is the convener of these integrated discussions. In the sense that it's very integrative and there is proof of concept, even beyond proof of concept, that geoinformatics research is very much sitting at the core of the transdisciplinary discussions. So I took liberty to select a title from what I conceptualized from the very broad theme of the conference about like Geoinformatics Research Conference. And decided to bring in a little bit of human aspect, human dimension, and realism in respect to where knowledge generated matters. And one of the key aspects indicated in this contract is the long couple of differently grouped in Uganda that is known as the Uganda Department and its passports. If you compare them, they are not the only passports, but if you compare them with the other prosperous groups, there's been transformation in one group or two, others and not the other. And the explanations and thinking and attitude about this report is that they are very slow in adapting and adopting and that they need to do certain things. So we moved in and I wish to acknowledge that this work partly comes from a program which is building resilience to adaptation to climate change and extreme disaster to breast. It is done to be one of the most funded global climate change adaptation program funded by the Department of Finance, International Development of the UK, and having about lighthouse projects, about six of them across the globe, most of which are actually within either semi-arid or arid regions. In Africa, it's the Sahel and Uganda, Kenya, and also Central Asia in these different, but the Kajikistan countries and several other places. So, Masiko was the lead in this program. And I also acknowledge some of my graduate students, Ambrose and Bevan, who are paid behind a good amount of the work. It's still a work in progress. We're doing much more than what I'm going to talk about. I feel that the examples and illustrations I'm going to share with you speak not only to the transdisciplinarity, but also to where knowledge matters most, that is generated, and what needs to be done, and evidence that the long-established tradition in Uganda, that something pops up, and there's a big fix, because somebody has an opinion about it, is not the way to go. So thank you again, Anthony and my colleagues, for this opportunity to speak about what I think I'm passionate about. I want to also introduce that in the spirit of transdisciplinarity and coordination of knowledge, the great number of actors in formal organizations, but also very clear-headed, motivated individuals from the number of organizations working in the Karamoja region that are part of this co-generational knowledge that we're going to share. So I won't go in detail naming all of them, but the list is there. And of course, the communities of the first ones, actually the Elders Council, which is also represented there in Karamoja, which is very influential and perhaps the nucleus of any kind of planning and decision making in respect to how resources can be utilized in that greater region. So, in terms of my outline, I should mention that there is definitely no doubt about rapid environmental change, and instead of talking about climate change, I decided that I brought it up a little bit to highlight this fact that the environment is changing. How many people were in forest 20 years ago. You can put up your hands. You see that there are not many. So if one wants to recap or to recall the images of the forest lands in central Uganda, later in the world of Kami Wale, just for one transit overall, the changes and the scraping of the land, terrestrial ecosystem in this part of this matter is so clear and it is so drastic in the sense that what used to be 20 years ago is not what you see now. With the much booming of different real estate developments, industrial complexes, and many other things. That is only good when you think about the economics. But that is again questionable. But you can only understand the full scale at which and magnitude of which environment is changing even in this very localized place if you start thinking about the environment in general. And I'm talking about ecosystem services, I'm talking about airports, I'm talking about water, and I'm talking about, of course, biomass that we've been on for so many things in this kind of country. So at that scale, the environment is changing rapidly. At the global scale, it is changing perhaps even more rapidly. By the RRB, the government panel on ecosystems and biodiversity, the best, which is the newest, IPCC, of course, on climate change, with the World United Nations program, and all these speak to a very serious, slow-paced sometimes change at a scale which is planetary, at which we, as the human society on this planet, don't know whether it will be reversed or stabilized. It's definitely important because a lot of things that we're doing, we're using, a lot of things that we treasure are actually derivatives from the environment. That is something that is not like what happens. You can think of anything on you and around you. It comes from the environment. Therefore, the changes that are happening are very many. And some of those drivers, which are also changing, have to do with the demographic and social dimensions, but others have to do with the economics of it. And there's a very, 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 very clear and loud call now that the economics has to change if we can stabilize the planet. And of course, Africa is not only changing drastically and fast. Africa is the last continent to evolve to the level
about resilience, which concept is moved from ecology
to the human relations, coupled human environment system. So resilience is a concept that obviously some of you will contest this in our discussion in terms of what it means, but it is a concept that would be useful to start thinking about a holistic way of managing the planet. Of course, there are many concepts that I can bring in here, but I just want to point out one, that the Stockholm Environmental Institute at some point published or launched a very kind of groundbreaking piece of research that actually spoke to the planet as a boundary system, planetary and planetary boundaries, in the sense that we need another planet if we continue to consume the way that we are consuming. So there are bounds or boundaries beyond which we do not go very far. So what then is the goal of creating resilience given the environmental changes happening? I think that the goal of that is to really influence not only discussions and not only policy, but also action, practice, such that we can have very innovative means through which we reduce vulnerability, improve decency of life. Economics will definitely want to chip in there very quickly. Eradicate poverty and increase people's well-being and income, right? And all this is happening at multiple scales. So you can think of grandmother, grandfather, and having a household somewhere in Khalil, in Eastern Uganda. But you can also think about the region, the territory, as Northern Uganda, in Eastern Uganda, or Northern Uganda in some regions there. And then you see that at multiple scales, you really have serious challenges and problems in respect to creating life that is decent, yet we depend on our nature. And therefore, why do we have to think about resilience? I draw these graphics from the BREAST program. And in BREAST, or even in literature, the understanding is that there are some thresholds, of course it's not a single threshold. There are bounds plus or minus within that threshold, where we can have a certain level of awareness. But through time, certain things happen, environmental changes happen, and some of these occur as shocks. Many of them occur as variable changes in very key parameters that will determine wellness. One of that is climate change. The other is biodiversity loss. And that is interacts with vulnerabilities and the sensitivities of different entities. You can think of human beings, you can think of infrastructure, you can think of housing, you can think of roads and everything. You can think of it as entities. The shocks and those which are chronic interact with vulnerabilities to produce, now this is the language of IRDR, to reproduce risk. And that risk comes from different things. Now, what happens if there is a shock? And I'll give an example later. That shock impacts on a unit, that unit could be a household, has maybe 10 cars, has maybe a few acres of superiors or something like that. That shock, if it comes in form a dry spell extending well into the expected normal range, means that the production of those fields and the cows will be affected. Either the cows will die, or will be sold because they're about to die, or the crops will not yield good enough food to take that household food to the next period. And I think we saw this in 2016 as a nation. Those who are keen, 2 days ago, I think it was released by the Uganda Bureau of Statistics, the new statistics on inflation. And inflation jumped by about 1.6 points. Why? Because in the last season, there was mounted in terms of harvest. And that dampening was influenced by the fact that inflation of food products went down. So those indicators are useful to always look out for, but also to think about. When that shock happens, and whatever impact level magnitude or severity, that brings your unit of analysis. That unit of analysis may bounce back because maybe it has some resilience or adaptive capacity or external influence and support.
It may not bounce back, no more. Or it may actually withstand or withhold, cope with the shock. Or it may bounce back much better than the way it used to. Now, it is that space of failure, bounce back, and bouncing back better, that defines how resilient that unit will be. If it fails, the quick conclusion is that that unit of analysis is not resilient enough. If it bounces back, maybe to the stage, then perhaps that unit was not able to cope. If it bounces back better, then means perhaps there was not only ability to bounce back in a normal situation, there could have been an innovation that takes it at a different level. So if you take that frame and understand it, then we can zoom into parameter later and see how the shocks happening there can affect the life in these areas. So parameter is what I would like to zoom into, which is about syllabistics now. And through co-creation and co-generation of knowledge, our understanding of resilience in Cambodia is that communities should have the capacity to really utilize the traditional knowledge. For many other researchers and scholars, they would say communities should have the ability to understand socio-economic and core socio-ecological systems. Our going there and working there for the last 2.5 years is telling us that actually they might understand the socio-ecological systems much better than us. In fact, they do understand it much better than us. So the question then is, for resilience, how do they make use of the knowledge beyond the skill that they have been using it to learn, to cope, to adjust, and transform to these shocks? And again, I have an illustrative figure here that for resilience to shocks, it's important to understand resilience for whom? Resilience of what? That is the unit of analysis. Resilience to what? There are many risks. There are many shocks, some of which are once in so many times, extensive. Some of them are low probability but very high magnitude of impacts. So what happens? Resilience through what? And this is where we're starting to jump all these concepts around absorptive, adaptive, and transformative adaptation in resilience theory. And then you can have different outcomes. So those outcomes could be avoiding disturbance, bouncing back, better bouncing back, recovery, but worse off, or even complete collapse. Now, because there are so many interacting drivers and actors, it might be, depending on the magnitude of the shock or the disaster, it might be that collapse is on one end of the scale. That is something that there's a probability that it can happen. Low probability that it can happen. But it may never happen. Why? Because you have quite a number of actors and drivers and processes that can come in to enable these units of analysis, whether it's an individual, a household, or a community, to cope with that. And then, of course, the shocks happen somewhere as a result of exposure and sensitivity. And then you have to think about how to become absorptive and transformative and adaptive in order to build resilience. In the case of Cambodia, resilience of what implies some of these, but not exhausted. So villages, districts, households, fresh water, pasture, livestock, but also ecosystems. Now there are three key aspects of this slide for the case of Cambodia. That is water, pasture, and livestock. So the livelihood system, the social ecological complex systems in northeastern Uganda, Cambodia, are built around those three key elements. We know it. I'm just re-emphasizing it. We know it. They're built around that. But whatever these people do depends so much on the spatial, temporal availability of water. water and plastic. Now, geospatial tools as a computer of knowledge comes the point where the rubber hits the road. If you're driving a car, you study it, or the driveway, home, wherever, that rubber hitting the point is that road that is taking you wherever you want to go. That point, I want to think and believe that geospatial tools can be a basis to convene, to bring different actors around freshwater, pasture, and livestock to start not just a conversation, but conversations around different aspects in much detail that affect the resilience of the system. And this is what this slide is meant to communicate. So it's not just a random detected picture. The person in that picture is Emmanuel Chipanyang. The very is one of the young leaders and very knowledgeable person who is passionate about his culture. And he's at the forefront together with others in Taiwan to really promote the idea that in this ecosystem, pastoralism first. Initially, we did not believe them. Besides the academics, we hypothesized, we think, how can we do this with James? And start growing crops. I'll give my conclusion. We don't think so. Actually, we hypothesized that, but actually the data so far and the analysis that we've done using the special tools indicates that that may not be the wise decision to make. So, the question I have to appreciate is critical work. And then, resilience to what? It's climate shocks, it's floods, it's droughts, it's economic changes. As we moved in, climate shocks and droughts, or climate shocks that eventually translate to manifesting to droughts and floods, but eventually drought, was the highly hypothesized climate shock. But then, as we interacted more with different actors, we realized that economic changes are also very, very, very important. And why? Take a minute to mention later. This is an area that is experiencing an extensive exploration of material, value material, right? Value materials. So mining is going on there for some materials. For others, they're still trying to establish the quantities and the feasibility for economic extraction. So there is a very systematic trend of appropriating and therefore delimiting access to large chunks of land in Karachi. And that economic transformation, which will be leading to some employment opportunities and at national level, some income, but impacting negatively on the pastoralist system. And we're not saying that those economic changes are needed. Extractional mining is needed perhaps, but how is it being done? And what does it mean? If at all the carbonodomes do not have, which is the case, the life skill to put on the labor market, then what does it mean for them? So are you simply directly telling them, please migrate to other places? That's what they say. And then you have the mix of different programs that are going on, some deliberate programs from the OPM and governments telling traditional communities that you should improve your food security by growing crops. Now, what the benchmark for that is Southwestern Iran, because we know for those who are from Iran, so there is an international event, this one, you know the stretch of the seminary zone. But that seminary zone is not uniform in terms of the weather conditions. The Southwestern one is more moist. Northeastern one is more dense. So when some people see crops growing well, for example, in Chinoni or in Kibura, the assumption is that that can also be done well. If they see some bananas on certain hills of Isindo, then they assume that they even around and have increased, the bananas can grow. That is what I call highly opinionated, emotionally charged decision making. Highly opinionated, emotionally charged of decision making. And then on the other hand, they say, well, modernity can be defined by somebody who is living in a decent house. A decent house is defined by in the materials from which it is built, it should be permanent. And one of the indicators of the assumptions of that is the roof, which has to be corrugated edges. And some of the gifts money from the government and donors, those and views. And the other like corrugated iron roof house. In a Manyata architectural design, they stayed there for 1 week. During the Akam period, we talk about their traditional climatic weather seasons. During the Akam, and then they cannot sleep in there. They build another one just beside that house. So you can see again the definition of modernity. Now, meanwhile, if you go to Nachivale, know where Nachivale is? Maybe Sinji Rokai. If you go to Nachivale and you enter this refugee camp, you will find sharp dwellings for the refugees, Somali refugees. And then you will find a very strong pole protruding through the shaft. And on that pole is a digital television receiver. My question there is, what is the definition of modernity in certain samples of business? What is the definition of modernity? So I don't have answers to it, but is it possible that modernity in the context of some places of the company would be thought of slightly differently than beyond what is there on those materials, and then modernize them to a level that they can get to? By thinking, because here we are in these hanging slabs and column buildings and corrugated edges and tile roofs, that is modernity that should also be reflected in other parts of Uganda. I'm not sure that that is the way to go. So, geospatial tools could be a convener, or is a convener, as illustrated in this talk by Dr. Cheo, where the conversation starts around these many aspects. What can we do with our resources? We have to recognize that traditionally a lot of knowledge has been accumulated in this system for long. Many scholars will refer to it as TEK or TIK, traditional business knowledge, IK, business knowledge, or traditional environmental knowledge. Colleagues from botany, we talk about botany. Colleagues from meteorology and climatology, which partly are partly related strongly, we'll talk of ethnoclimatology and the climatology of the people, right? And then geographers, we will talk of citizen mapping and citizen science, citizen geography. So while you're moving around with your mobile handset and turned on your location services in the operating system, at the end of the day, you can map out all the places you've been going to. So you're collecting data for us. If we can get access to that data, then we can use it to convene conversations about not only your behavior, but what needs to do what, where, and at what time. Because it can tell us, the patterns can tell, and there is a core community that is emerging around big data on that. A core community emerging around that. So it means that geospatial tools are providing more information, and geospatial tools are moving, I shouldn't say that they have moved. They're moving from the non-professional contemporary measurement devices and approaches, like you see on that one, to much more smaller devices and sensors. And in fact, I'm not sure, but I think it was a tweet, Council of Arts and Science today, that today we might be having a number of sensors of different types and sizes that are way beyond the global population. So you can think of almost anything that is around you that is electronic as a sensor. That's what it means. And it's sensing different aspects in the environment, pollution, everything. So in geomatics, my colleagues in geomatics, land management, in physics, do the measurements, and then geoinformatics, we do the integration to produce the knowledge. Doesn't mean that geomatics does it, but certain knowledge which brings together society and different actors, and if it is generated, used as evidence, and shared across, then that's what we think is useful for society. And that's how the debate, perhaps on different aspects and topics, like climate change, is going on. So if in Cambodia building resilience would mean that we need to know certain things, even those that we do not know. And in this particular program, we had a discussion, it was a meeting, we invited initially. Then we were talking about ABCD, and then we thought, okay, I think we're talking about something in respect to biophysical conditions. But they are bringing individual experiences that are very local specific. Can we zoom out a little bit and start looking at it at a regional scale? Now, the individuals have a sense of the regional scale, but the geospatial tools provide a much more robust approach and platform for zooming out and looking at the biophysical conditions at the regional scale. And then we advise or we share, can we try these tools to generate information that would be useful? And then they insisted that actually, if you do that, we have to be part of it, and which was good. It's co-creation and co-generation of knowledge. We have to be part of it. But before I give those illustrations of how we went to do it, I just want to quickly brush over the issues of climate change in Uganda and the vulnerabilities, and which aspects need to be explored in resilience building. First of all, there's observed variation in terms of temperature and rainfall, and that is manifest in terms of non-uniform availability or variability of precipitation. I think we have some individual experiences around that. There are issues to do with the average number of hot days and average number of cold days. I think if you remember the period January through to early March, by experience, how many people experienced beyond usual heat in that period? Now the data we have already indicates that it was the number of average hot days were way more than what we consider as normal in that period. So there is that possibility of heat and heat wave, who knows, maybe we might start experiencing heat waves. And then of course cold days in places which are hot. In the places which are normally not cold, the number of cold days can also decrease. Now all those have an impact on not only health but several things. And then these maps simply show you the distribution of precipitation on the left, and on the right it shows over a 65-year period that we've analyzed how it has changed. The blue shade, if I'm wrong, you see it as blue, I'm not sure, because the RWFOC played streaks at some point, indicated that it's the 1 to 2 standard deviation below the average over that period. The red shade is up to 3 standard deviations above the normal in 60 period. And of course, it is around the territory. And we can, as somebody also working with the tourists, we know that Lake Victoria experiences convective today. Those convectives again occur, and the precipitation occurs of that lake. So over that period, almost the entire country has experienced at least one standard deviation below the average in terms of this. And that is revealing. And then if you look at these graphs, I just want to point out two. Most of these have two peaks here and there, but in this region, there is one peak. So Cambodia has this extended period, which has some seasons traditionally, which I'll be showing later. Akam, Akiboro, Akitaret, and Etief, where the rain builds from March, not so much, April, May, and then peaks between July, August, and then sharply drops in September, October, and November, December, January, February, very, very, very hot and dry. So one peak. And what that one peak means, depending on the amount of precipitation received, is that the productivity of the ecosystem in terms of biomass peaks at the point, some point in August, but then sharply drops in less than almost 2 months in October. By productivity, I mean if you have grass, the regrowth of that grass, or whatever the livestock are eating, and some of the plants are also drying up because of the heat. So the productivity of that ecosystem is high in the period between July through August and early season. And then the other seasons of other months, you do not have that much biomass. And then then what the curve turns to, we'll be talking about it. These two graphs simply show what is observed on your left in terms of variation in precipitation anomalies and what is predicted. And this graph uses the older generation of the global circulation models, not the new one. But the difference in terms of magnitude is not very much. So you have the HR model, and the red, the dark red, is June, July, August, September. They are very occasional points at which you have very below normal, abnormal rates. And this, we can refer back to the period of 2004, 2006, 2008. What is significant about that period in terms of precipitation? If everybody remembers, the drop in the lake levels. And as we speak now, the lake levels are up again. Have you heard about people who are complaining, losing their courtyards and their houses? I'm not sure if you do it. I'm not sure. I haven't listed them, but there's that possibility that the increase. Even in temperature also shows a similar trend. Again, observed and predicted by the global circulation models. But we know that the global circulation models are only representative of a long period of time. So they do not depict what will happen, but they give a sense of what might happen. And therefore, we can do a lot to reverse that. And because of these changes, there are particular vulnerabilities which I will not go into in detail, but the key ones for Cambodia, because of water, pasture, and livestock, is that the droughts have increased from once in about 6 years to once in 4 years, which means, and you know, that doesn't mean that every 4 years, you could have two droughts in successive seasons, and then you have another 4 years which have normal rains. So the chances of experiencing droughts in Cambodia and the country at large have increased. The country at large from once in 10 years to once in almost 2 years. But again, the magnitude of the droughts, again, is important to think about. Some of these droughts in the country, but which is low, with less impact or magnitude there. But of course, speaking about vulnerabilities, we cannot fail to mention the heavy rains, precipitation that comes excessively, knocks down fields and infrastructure, as well as the normal effects in terms of health. Now, for the case of Cambodia, the normal effect where flooding becomes important has to do with livestock disease. Because when you have too much water, then the livestock will have a problem. So how did the geospatial tools become enablers in these conversations? When we did the proposal, many people were skeptical about it, including the many NGOs and collaborators working in Cambodia. They were very skeptical about it, but we initially knowing that it would take a bit of time. And then we went into a process of data hunting, and we looked at the Sentinel data. We also looked at the Landsat archives, and we were able to download data which was less, or with cloud cover, with less cloud cover, for 2014 and 2016, to try and understand the spatial tempo over a period of time. How has Cambodia landscape behaved? And then from that we can maybe make or inform how it has changed. So we did that, and then we processed the images and classified them in the little words here, the different classes we looked at. These are different stacks of classified maps and images for the different years, and then quantified biomass, and we're now getting our heads into understanding not only the spatial temporal variation but also the carrying capacity. So if we know that there's one peak, and for the longer period over the rain season, the moisture available may not support the level of crops that would enable Cambodia to be food secure at the level that is thought of by some people, then we have to find evidence with the pastoralists that pastoralism has been resilient for a long time and how they manage that. So that is what is taking us into analyzing the current capacity of the landscape, which also requires that we have to know the number of livestock, which is
very difficult.
Also, again, this is where then we get criticized that any human nature analysis is not relevant. It's not useful because you're assuming that there are 1.5 million livestock heads, but they are actually 800,000. So, but then we have means through which we have run kind of stress tests and also verification of this data, and we feel that we have made this scientific contribution to really getting these answers to this question of is pasteurism the way to go in carbon. So, but we're not asking that in the context that we want to go pasteurism, no, but rather support pasteurism. So at the end I made point to certain things. So this is just an example of screenshots of the four-color images. On the left is Akam. Akam is that period of November, February, and that is 2000. The image, the November, February does not refer to the date of capture of the image, but rather the Akam period, which is the dry. And I use this just to contrast. You can see Cambodia is quite dry. This is in Kenya, by the way. Cambodia is dry to the east and moist as you move into the western part of it. So much of this is actually Amolata, Lira, and Kikum and other places. And then of course if you look at these two images, because of the intensity of biomass in the rainy season, actually is the rainy season, the peak, Akam is the prime period, you can see the difference in the landscape. But again, you also see something on this image, or screenshot of the images, there is a haze around here. That looks like haze, but that haze is smoke. This is smoke because a lot of burning occurs in these places, and it's not really making carbon. So just to show you a little bit of that raw data that we use, then we classify the images. Then Akam 2000, Akam 2016, and the red is fire scarred areas. The light green is grass, which could be dry or very tall or short grass, and then the darkish green is shrub, and then the last very deep dark green is forest. So between the two, you can again see that there's also a time element here, a temporal element. That is 2000, and this is 2016. 16 years, you already start to see some changes in the landscape that is happening. The white area here is likely bare soil, and sand, they're not sand dunes, but sand, the patches of sand in the area, and that is largely between Moroto and Kuchiko. So there's a lot of dynamics of the landscape in that place. So that shows you that within 16 years, the landscape has changed. So then we present this, discuss this, understand the composition about it, and then it's asking, oh, now we recognize it. Go to Kobebe. Kobebe is the largest dam that was constructed in Cambodia, which is used for watering not only livestock but also wildlife. Then you walk and have a stretch that almost is devoid of any biomass, and that is the white patch in the middle there. So that is one example. All of the years have been analyzed, but the presentation, in this presentation, I want to give you an example. And then in the wet season in 2000. That's what it looked like on your left. As you can see, it is really highly productive. It used to be highly productive. And on the right, you start getting areas which were very difficult, or patches that were very difficult for us to classify, which is the black. But we combined unclassified pixels, but also water and bare soil. And this is in the dry part. Now, this is the eastern part, bordering Turkana, and which is much drier. And then again, you see that to the west of Cambodia, which is in Tesson and in Kitgum, you get high productivity of the ecosystem in terms of biomass. So these two sets of maps give us snapshots of two time event landscape situations. Now, what we're going to do is to work into what variation occurs even per pixel over the number of years that we have classified and analyzed. That is not yet here in this presentation. But the conversations that have emerged around these products is that now we have the region of it. Now we get a sense of it. And then I'll show, or I'll talk about the situation where the traditional socio-ecological knowledge actually meets with these modern geospatial tools of knowledge generation. And then this map simply shows you a graded livestock particular cattle population. So I told you about the data on livestock, right? It's very challenging to get. By a graded means we boxed the number of livestock per a certain unit on the ground, which is 1 kilometer grid. Because we know that the cattle is not everywhere. The livestock system or pastoralism system in Cambodia is based on elders, herders, crowd leaders and herders. The crowds are a distance from the households, and that distance can be as much as 100 kilometers. That's why you have a concentration of maybe 2-3 crowds with as many as 3,000, 4,000 heads of cattle. They only bring the elderly and those to go to the market type of livestock and cattle back home if they are going to sell. And then in the homestead, they keep those that are young or those that are elderly and sickish before they return them, if they will ever return. Otherwise, they will make it to the livestock market. So we boxed or graded, hopefully more professionally, the livestock in a 1 kilometer grid. So for you may not see the grids in here, but it's 1 kilometer resolution. And you can see, I will point out, areas of Moroto coming into Nakapri grid have been Kabon Kotido are the ones with the highest concentration of cattle livestock. And that tells us something already. What does it tell us? That these people concentrate their livestock in a particular area, but their herding range is quite long. So they herd for as long as 40-45 kilometers. But that is not morning, evening. No. That is Monday, Thursday. So the range of herding is quite long. And this map, in a way, is the big stuff. So this is the data. It's not just the map. Behind it is data. As you can see here, this is the data that we'll use to really get our heads into the herding capacity in Kalamaja to do that. So, besides the image classification, we also use participatory geospatial tools to get a sense of those individual locale specific knowledge about the stratigraphic system and be able to map it at a regional scale. This is just pictures showing the process in all the 7 districts that we went to, consulting with elders, crowd leaders, and herders, and even women. They may not be very diversity, but because women are responsible for the shores, so the sheep and goats and things like that, they are part of these processes and are very much supported by people and organizations that are working there, like GIC, VSF Belgium, and Cambodia Development Forum, and all those organizations. So when it comes to representation in this mapping exercise, then we think that it was high accuracy. These are a few of the many pictures we took different locations of Cambodia. You can see the kind of bare land and sands in the, one of the pictures there that I was talking about. I think that is close to Kobebe, right? That is close to Kobebe, that stretch of the north reserve is actually almost like a desert. Almost like, but not a desert, please. Don't put me wrong. It's almost like a desert. And of course, the many people involved. For what use was this participatory kind of mapping? There are three important things for the Kalamajor. One is that whenever they have, because of that range I've talked about, there are conflicts. But there are also conflicts that are emerged by the appropriation of land for mining and even agriculture, especially in the park towards Irei in Katapi, which is a little bit wetter, given the war in Abin. So conflicts, there are so many conflicts, but conflicts related to land use and land utilization became very, very significant. And those conflicts directly imply that the land is appropriated, blocked off, and people will not be able to graze in those areas as they used to. Then the third one is that one means through which the Kalamajoka customs can be being resilient for them is through short-term migration. short-term migration to the west of Cambodia, that is into Makati, Komi, into Kitukum, in Moria, where you have extensive wetlands in which they can graze. And that even extends the hunting range. So this short-term migration is characterized by very historical long-standing relationships with the Itesos and the Labos, as well as the people in Kobe, through cultural negotiations, allow us to go through and we create, we'll go back, we'll take care of your crops. That has happened. Now, many opinionated leaders in this country have that detail, or if they do, they decide to negate it. And we think that the conversation that is emerging out of geospatial tools being a convener sharing the importance of this knowledge which alone has been either business school or not taken seriously. And then the third one is that they have particular pressing areas. And then they were able to give an indication of where they used to map historical areas and where they are currently mapping. And then this next series of maps, which also almost are getting to the end of the presentation, give a sense of what they used to do and what they are doing. And like I said earlier, build on what is there, build resilience, that brain leaders starting something new. Maybe the answer is in here. Maybe the answers are in here. So on the left you have grazing past, and this is the area that I've been talking about in the Dove Reserve. What's the difference between these maps? You notice an expansion of the whitish areas. That means a reduction in grazing areas. What reduces the input? Reduces the grazing areas, agriculture, conservation, and mining. So before you take Ramadans to turn to crops, think about a holistic, systematic understanding of all different utilizations and things happening in these labs. So mining, between these two, you can see the change. This is the newest present, those white areas. And then of course the hot areas, idea they no go, but in practice there is grazing in them. No go means reserves, national parks. The upper most common, the upper top is Kidepo, this is the north, this is Piantope, but people still graze there, and wildlife and livestock still interact. So they may not be so much a big problem there. They used to migrate, and they future a few. Very significant differences in these two maps, the past and present. If you look at the map of the past around here, you'll notice that the migration routes reduce in the present event. That is partly because of security, it's also partly because of the conservancy, and partly because of the armed Turkanas on this side. So around Mount Moroto, that is no longer a migration route. But again, you can see that the intensity of migration routes around here, coming through Napan to Amuria and Abib, it also reduces. And that means that the western part of Cambodia, Tesoland, Daboland, is no longer penetrating for grazing. Why? Because one of the reasons, agricultural patches that have been stopped. Or they may not be fenced off, but the moment security guys see that cows are grazing close to an established farm, then they will come and chase it out. So it means they know what they're doing. Now, that affects the seasonal migration, and it affects their grazing and hiding patterns, which means that actually pastoralism is under threat. That's the conclusion that you can draw from this maps. And then the last set of maps is to do with conflicts. And we only came to this data and information after interacting with them, we will never know that they are conflicts. That the biggest number of conflicts are related with mining sites. Because with mining sites, no go ahead. So whether it is this other side of Aberdat or Livestock and in Rupa around here for gold and bubble or in a park area for the exploration going on there, these blocks of land have been appropriated and bounded off. where conflicts are emerging, because if you overlay those are the migratory territories, and if you overlay water resources, you can see the blue lines here, some of the dams are located there, some of the water dams constructed by government are within the conservancies, and the mandating institution is more and more pushes them off. So then they start questioning, whose water is it? Now, the interesting thing that comes from this maps of conflict and migration is that towards the conclusion of the discussions, they say we go in this direction to follow our water. Because the topography is such that it rains here in the higher lands and then drains to the west. So, Bissinia, Moga, all those, we are following our water. So, that was very interesting. The water comes from Cambodia, and then it was in Cambodia that the water you can receive a downpour of 30 minutes. Too much water, then if you are walking in that storm, it's like you are fighting the current, right? And then in another 8 to 17 minutes, or maybe 15 minutes, dry. You may be looking through the valleys of the streams, no water. It runs very fast, the west. So they follow their water. Now, of what importance is these tools and what kind of compositions have emerged with the geospatial tools? Issues to do with hardening decisions. The harders started saying, yes, we have been traditionally making decisions on where to hard, but now these maps at the regional scale show us the X that are the limitations. So we need to change the decisions in respect to where to hard and when. Issues to do with general migration, they now know that they have very limited areas where to migrate to. But they still hope that the traditional system, because they either have the businesses also have the areas council. So these councils meet regularly. And they have working groups. They also meet regularly. So the hope is that that traditional way of conflict resolution and negotiation for Adi during hard periods of biomass scarcity, then they can work around solutions in respect to that. They started to converse around marketing of livestock, which takes the whole conversation into a different unit of discourse, universal discourse, which was how do you improve the product, how do you market it, how do you add value to it? That we have to work on it. The partners are going to work on it, but this data or just tools are provided to us something about that. And then two key things came up. One is that they think and we think that it's high time that there's a much more regional, large-scale planning around water resources. Because if you have a downpour of work, you 25 millimeters in a space of a period of 30 minutes. 25 millimeters, that is a lot of rain. It's a lot. How do you turn that resource and use it and invest it? There's demonstration of the large volumes, but that may not be the solution. So different technologies are being thought of as part of water resource planning to provide water, which is key for pastures. Again, grazing is also becoming key because the maps are delivering the message and information of which areas within this landscape are highly productive over a period of time and at what time, and therefore where can we do the grazing. But beyond that, now this is the rest of the repository, it's important to start thinking about carrying capacity. So if you take a sub-region, maybe in a park or maybe a corridor, and get the information which we have already, the range of hiding and the biomass productivity, how many heads of livestock can be supported by the biomass? Therefore, what does it mean in the herds? How many livestock do you have? And if they also work on the marketing and the value chain, then that could also help in improving the value of the product. Each product is starting off as live animal that ends somewhere on our this year as barbecue meat, somewhere here, and in different places. So what value would be added there? So the geospatial tools are providing the information and knowledge to really deepen the conversation around these issues of water and grazing planning. So I would like to conclude by saying that no doubt, we have from the preliminary results that pastoralism is resilient, but there is still a temporal spatial problem of the stock of biomass and the productivity of the ecosystem. this, I wish that the minister and the ministers were here.
There's a minister from Cambodia that you know.
Yeah, the former, the previous minister was really promoting.
Talks.
We have to build them as for people that. That is not the way to go.
And
do not force Cambodians to plant. Yes, they can plant, but they can plant crops like barley, beans, and only in specific places. Because some of you may have still seen the TV footage of, was it MTV or MBS or something like that, a couple of months ago, showing how the job started. That was not a true record. No, it was not a true record. The best that they claim to have shown is Rupa. I was there during that period. Rupa, the maps are offered. I was there. You see. So sometimes this is what I call highly opinionated question and tell the question, no? Some of these journalists also over-amplify certain things. There's the earlier people who have very limited space of survival. So they go and shoot one, two, and then they generalize that Cambodians are dying. But the Cambodians know how to survive. So the message is, at the moment, the climate, if you want them to grow crops, then change the climate. And how can you see a change the climate? Because the climate is changing and it's forcing us to change. But somebody else wants the climate to be changed in order to support crop growing. And there's even now a demonstration starting in one of the government's breeding farms somewhere in the country, in Amalu. By the way, they're even distributing. I think 50% freezer livestock in Cromwell. Yes, they have distributed them. And there's a guy that I talked to from around Rupa, which is going to be Singa, who has one, and he's still at the age of the broader town council. The cost of buying feed for it is higher than almost three times the value that you can get from the milk. Then I was like, why do you still have it? Well, this was the project. And what if they come and cheer for me and I don't have it, what will I do? Yeah, but she's cutting deep into your eyes. Yeah, I still have to be with that guys, then we'll see what you do. So you can imagine the higher opinion and the emotional challenge decision making that you can see or to think that Frisians can do well in Cambodia. And I'll let conclude by saying that this points to planning. And planning that could be supported by geospatial tools and information generated around by information to tell us what productivity level, what stock of biomass, how much water could be available in this system all the period of time, and therefore what value chain of livestock can do well or survive and be resilient in this ecosystem. Thank you very much for your attention.
As you have seen, I think you couldn't have gotten a better person to give us this overview. Many times we are in our cocoons, you know, remote sensing classification, etc. Now it has helped us zoom out to see the consequences of all those things. I think 80% of you have gone through, maybe 70% of you have gone through my hands. I've been struggling with you in the environmental studies and the like. So, I am glad the Prof has used this opportunity to shed more light on these key issues. I'm going to open the floor for two or three questions, and after informing them, I will start with my Prof. I'm curious about Cambodian pastoralists. What are their of the land? What are their land to your land only? As people come to demarcate the land and are introducing new concepts, putting aside land because previously, where available is that source of conflict.
first question was, if your website, if your website impacts on the registration cover in Estrian, the region, in the protected areas, because their accidents were quite similar in both time periods. In 2016, the blockchain was a major
Yes, one more question before. Yes, Max.
That informally, the UA allows them to raise at certain points in time, and then at certain points in time it does not allow them to raise. An example, grazing or water, for example. Komebe is the largest town. Effectively, continue what it was to Europa and Morocco, that the government collaboratively developed. It's not entirely the government of Uganda, but the government. And it was built as a dam along one of the hydrological features of the mountains in Kabak. It holds quite a large amount of water, compared to the capacity. Is within the protected area. And it was done for the reason of livestock. And because government was aware, then they had permanent wildlife. Now there are very dynamic processes of accessing Kobebe Dam for water. And it's not only the Matadiko or the Rock, but also the Tukana who come to that dam with their animals to get water. For their animals. So there's a certain period in Akan, that's around December through to February, when Kobebe receives a huge amount of livestock from as far as Tukana. And that causes unease in the security agencies in Kobebe. It's sensitive because some of these Tukanas are out. And of course, as law enforcers, they go in and say, we need to push them back. But these guys have had very long historical established relationships and agreements to access these resources. So then the question, coming back, because I'm philosophizing, is it illegal or not? Then it is not a matter of black and white, so perhaps several shades of gray between us. So it is yes and no. It's illegal but not illegal. But not illegal. You can think of that as informal, I'm not sure it's informal, but I think it is basically an understanding of the actor containing on the situation. And it's not just about the criminal jokes, but also the Tukan part of that story. And the impact on vegetation cover by infrastructure, as you may have noticed or know, Kanamoja is quite an expansive area. Just the way from Kanamoja from Tukana, Kenya border to Labo is I think 145 kilometers straight distance, Ukrainian distance, right? And then the y-axis is even much longer, all the way up to Ngenge and the parts of Islam. It's quite a big area. The infrastructure getting in there is this much. So there isn't that much in terms of impact on by infrastructure on vegetation. Impact is much more felt, but again in a very small degree with mining areas. And these are very, very confined places. The problem with mining areas, if you go to Abudas, the mining areas do not only clear vegetation for areas where extraction goes on, but the extraction process, the transportation process, reinforces toxins that are affecting wildlife and plant life. So some areas in the Abudas actually would be starting to face that kind of situation. There's only one road which has been tarmacked so far, that is the Makabiri Ridge to Moroto. They're going to start Soroti. It's a stretch of 160 kilometers. The view from there is very, very good. They are not, there isn't that much in terms of density of growth. So this area is quite remote, quite remote. In terms of other infrastructure that you can think of, again, the equipment is very, very, very good. And then the question on so many issues in respect to climate change, in respect to land use change, and whether there's data. Now, specifically to land use data, We all know that when you do classify an area for land use, a great degree of the definition of the land use classes is subjective. The approach we use here is that where there is a less degree of subjectivity, much more based on
sense in terms of what is happening on every crunch in terms of land use. So we may not be using land use. We are going to be still working with dynamic of literacy. We are working with climate literacy, a short roadmap of the climate 65-year period, preservation of nutrition, and temperature. The challenge with that literacy is that there are only 2 out of 7 weather stations for wind data was available in the region. So when we did the interpolation, it was based on very minimal weather station data, but also gas in the period of time that we specified field. But again, that tells you that it's not really precise. So in terms of analysis, it's estimates rather than the actual 50-year period. But the general picture is actually what we want. Of course, we're interested in the specific picture as well, and much more local specific unit. But the thing is that when it comes to climate, you can only make use of local climate data and sense, because microclimate data sets may not be very useful in decisions around productivity of ecosystems. But we acknowledge all those important things. So perhaps what you're talking about is we have the climate models in here. I showed at least 3 of them in the predicted. And then of course the actual observed data for the system, which is not climate change, but they can be able to discern some aspects of the variation when they need to change.
Yeah, thanks. When you talk about the confluence of land increase, I also reminded that our partner Dr. Seming is thanking together the proposed master and other administration. And I think those intricacies will come with the investigate the side one and chat to the fourth. I was intrigued by the story about the Karamojong following the out and was bring up in value to people of their I don't know if they were following the water or if they were looking for the few cows. In our region, you know, having 3 cows, you are aware of what they used to cows, and then the cows, all the cows in the world are there, it's just straight and I'm just curious, so the time when Kapara Stream was being, it has been used. Is that another part of the
stage of modernization at our level where we are and we continue. Because I have this saying that if peeling off the forests for furniture or digging into the ground for gold is going to kill our environment, why don't we remain in the trees and be bushmen and we continue being happy instead of having this nice furniture and nice looking rings and necklaces and we continue struggling for adaptation. So which one is better? Which one would you advise? Adaptation or conservation?
Both. Yes, your voice is very loud.
I just want to know the process.
Thank you for the really wonderful questions. Mineral reports, maybe I can start from there. Those that I know that are being extracted in a small hole, I'm going into this debate over whether it is partial extraction or still exploration. Limestone, the key minerals that I extracted at a commercial scale, limestone, because it's really in the mineral industry and bubble. Thinking, walking around, you know, processing plant and you go back to Morocco. So that already could be having an investment going in that. I feel that there could be other minerals. Gold is mainly a good thing, why you're saying it's all about the private control because that are deep. Alluvial mining is largely surface and subsurface in a different way. Yeah, if we can go to the question of do we adapt or do we conserve? Allow me then to really classify a little bit about the notion of conservation. If you trace the history of that, you will find that we also talk about preservation. And it seems as if what you're referring to could be pretty much the domain of preservation. Conservation was evolved after preservation with the thinking that it's possible for humanity to live on nature and with nature. So utilization at a scale and level for which existing services and processes will continue. But the thing is that finding the normality of ecosystems to continue the way they are when you use certain aspects of them is the key challenge. And then that brings in other discussions around thresholds, tipping points, and resilience. So if you want to use the forest sustainably for furniture, for beds, right? So those are my more general question. Why do we need these people here, a mile or two there, and a mile or two, right? All the time. I mean, I have a bed, why should we leave them around? They should go, because I have a bed, but I didn't know that the other people were coming into this world. And then the other people who are changing. Now, that speaks to the complexity of utilization, sustainability, and conservation. That finding the thresholds where we can extract at a level that would allow ecosystems to maintain their ecosystem processes is one of the grand challenges, even for future Earth, if you are familiar with the global research agenda. So it's not, again, a question of conservation or preservation. And it's neither is a question of adaptation or resilience. Resilience and adaptation speak more to vulnerability. Adaptation is the broader domain within which you discuss what makes people vulnerable to perturbations that affect them either to fail, collapse, bounce back better, or even change the new normal. And adaptation and resilience are simply part of reduction. So again, there are not really specific aspects that can be addressed without looking at the broader picture of vulnerability. So the question there is not much deeper, it's not in a whole, but rather the complexity. Now, my response to you is that what is needed is the systematic thinking about the systemic nature of how these different elements interact to produce and reproduce risk, to limit or enhance the ability of certain communities and individuals to access decent life, not forget about those who appropriate, extract, and build wealth, and they pose around as being super because they are much more working than the others. So think about the forest. Somebody goes to Bukunjiri. That's down Rangi Forest, over the period of course. Comes and builds apartments here, and then he is posing around as being rich.
who tells him or her that I don't have a right over ranging forest, as you are doing? So those are the deeper questions. Now, in order to do that systematic, systemic interactional analysis, there are new things that are emerging. And I'll just pick one of them, which is the green economy and green economy and green growth. And this is not just a whitewash. This is an area that is uncluttered. This has the definitions, people working in data to really, and I like the question of models. This has to really generate the knowledge and models needed to find out how green we can be. It's also to use the forest sustainably while we allow it to reproduce biodiversity. It's also very possible to use the water source like Lake Victoria or a river or you know, a small Isilia Lake. As long as we understand its richer capacity and as long as we understand the environment in which it's blessed, such that we can model and be able to predict that at this point in time, given the prediction of precipitation over the next 5 years, instead of abstracting 10 million cubic meters of water, let's abstract 7 million cubic meters of water. And the rest, please don't harvest the rainwater of the Amazon that is coming on the roads. It's that kind of understanding. If you can get any reference now or link to California, state in the US, they've just gone through a 2 year period of very serious drought, the most severe in over 14 years. And then within no time, over 2 weeks, they received an atmospheric river that delivered and returned or refilled or returned the reservoirs at a level that they have not attained in the last 10 years. We can generate, if we can design and come up with models that help us do that, then we can think about conservation. We can work much more properly in conservation. If I bring it back together, the brains are here, but the brains are not here. Mark my sentence, highly opinionated emotional challenge response. That is the characteristic. So that is my response to that. So we need systematic planning, which is new. And then the question of models to address land change and deforestation and relocation of wetlands. Yes, partly my response to them response, but I also feel that it's important to seriously start thinking about a national level planning, which might make some people uncomfortable because there has to be a limit beyond which we will not open. I, as an individual or anybody, will not open a piece of land for agriculture or a house unless it is so much required. And I can say that for almost 15 years of deep thinking and I did some analysis and calculations that if you look at the population in Uganda, 80-70% is rural. But the majority of population in Uganda is below 33 years. What are they doing in rural Uganda? They're just hanging around in towns like Asensio, in Uganda, in Isidio, brokering, Matoke, brokering this kind of things. I think that question should be in urban areas. But the urban areas must be prepared to absorb that question. That question must be trained, have skills that are marketable, perhaps in the new economy. Now, all that requires deep thinking, and I'm not sure that it exists in Uganda. It seems to be dealing with crisis management. Every other time, something comes up, a crisis, a commission, or a study, and then a big and then the study is forgotten and then a new crisis emerges. So that seems to be the cycle, if you will, for a post like Uganda. So when it comes to your fears, I'm sure that they are everybody's fears, even though you may not be able to articulate them the way you are. Those are our fears. What is the intercept for that? Planning is one of those. And as researchers, we need really to begin. This long standing divide between academicians or researchers as theorists and practitioners are the people who deliver. Now we see what they are delivering. It's what you're saying. People who are giving away wetlands, people who are now in, you know, wildlife and trophies sell, people who are doing all kinds of things. That is the delivery. If that is the delivery, then the academicians and researchers in general think that should challenge that and question it. But the problem is that there is no space for that dialogue and engagement. It's not one that would be of confrontation. It's the time that would be utilizing the brains and not emotions.
my part. So that is my response. I'm not sure it's a straight answer, but I think that it is worth mentioning that. We do have satellite data. My question to you is, what nature satellite data are you interested in? We have an archive of land site from 97, 2000. That is less cloud cover. 2014, 2016. So if you're interested, you can contact me. You can give maybe what is heavy, maybe some scenes or particular. That is particularly for Kamwanji. We also do have for the entire country, for the previous years of 1970 and up to I think 2000. But I'm not sure where that data is. When my parents transited and transitioned into colleges, there was a mess in our department as we transitioned into that. So I'm not sure, and I lost the one that I had backed up from one of my desktop external drive, which was stolen from the office by somebody else, so, who thought they had more value for the nature, so you can imagine. But we do have something that we can do there. For those who want to do research, then we can share the archive from our project, if you're interested in working, which is why I would like to work on. Department, this area is under research on many topics. Land is one of them, and I think it offers a very good research field for our students in various fields, surveying, mathematics, geography, living sociology, and whatever. This area is under research. It's been neglected for a long time. I could pitch around pocket stepping here for really launching this master's in land administration in Karamoja, because it's very, very, very interesting. And then when it comes to your previous historic experiences of all cattle and livestock belongs to us,
yes.
there has been a significant reduction of cattle rustling, and the number of drivers are factors for that. Improvement in security, beefing up of security, disarmament, of course, plays a very key role. And the control of the international boundary between Kenya and Uganda. Others. But there could be, this is what we are going to work on, there could be something to do with the contribution of the variable and shifting climates and environmental landscape in our body, because the livestock would survive if it can access water. If temporarily we know that in the months of November, December, January through February, there is such severe scarcity of water and water, then most people will have to move. And the reason will not be the cattle they find there is theirs. The reason will be we're looking for pasture. But if we find some few hens in quail and whatever, then we can go with them. But that is changing. That is changing, and it has reduced. The cattle rustling has reduced very, very drastically. And the other key factor for that reduction also relates to the Council of Elders in Karamoja. Which Council of Elders is very active, meeting regularly and meeting with elders in Teso, meeting with elders in the Boko and Poem, meeting with elders across the court as well as Tukana to resolve some of these issues. So you can think of them as gentle names or gentle elders agreements, but they do have agreements to settle this kind of problems. And of course, the Council of Elders also established penalties for whoever. Head of cattle, and that is restraining a lot of the hunters who are very powerful and strong to pick what they think is theirs, finding it before the other person goes away.
Yeah, thank you. I thank Prof for that wonderful discussion. Hopefully, it's not the last we'll be seeing or thing. So, thank you very much for your patience, and for those of you who will be staying on for the conference tomorrow. Keynote speaker, the next part of big data, I can talk about big data, how do we harness the material, especially that's being generated for something useful. We shall be having that tomorrow onwards, so please welcome for a cup of tea and enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you.